This is a song for anyone with a broken heart. This is a song for anyone who can't get out of bed. I'll do anything to be happy. Oh, 'cause blue skies are coming, but I know that it's hard. Still in love with you.
This is the last song. Yeah, somebody should explain, like, the difference between them.
You can find Northwest oyster mushrooms by looking for white or bright spots on dead standing trees or downed trees such as logs.
And it's probably about maybe 50 yards through the woods, and I can just see a tiny bit of something that looks like it shouldn't be there. Like the snowball head of an eagle when it's sitting in an evergreen tree. These are oyster mushrooms, and they're growing on an alder log, and alders are really popular wood for one of the species, one of the two Northwest oyster mushroom species to grow on. And this one here, what's nice about it is it's got a pretty firm cap. I don't see any lines in it from beetles that have been trailing through eating the delicious fruit. And this is growing slightly on the side of the log, and you can just kind of pull them off. And you can see inside, they've got gills that are fanned out. And the gills are slightly decurrent, which means they go down the side onto the stalk. And this is just a very, very nice oyster mushroom for eating. Now we're gonna pick a few more, and I'm gonna put these in a net bag so that the spores can fall out of the holes as we're walking around. So these ones here, they can be just pulled off. They're just a really nice size for putting into a stir fry right now. They're very fresh. And when they're growing on the side of the log here, they get a panhandle type of stalk. When they grow on the top of the log, they get a stalk that goes underneath. It's got a stalk that's pretty much slightly off center. And that slightly off-center stalk is very indicative of one that grows on the top of the log. You can confuse these with a poisonous mushroom that does have a central stalk. So I can see the slug was eating there. So this one here, it's also on a alder log. But it's very different. You've got a stalk that's central. The gills don't come down the stalk from underneath the cap like these ones do. They go right down to the edge. But someone that didn't know what they were doing may possibly pick the wrong one if it were up on top. I'm just gonna put that back.
These are angel wing mushrooms, and they have a pure white cap. They grow on conifer wood, and they can be cumulatively poisonous. These have been eaten for decades by Northwesterners, and yet just recently in Japan, some elders died from a dinner of angel wings. So this particular mushroom is now in question.
This is the real chanterelle. This is a false chanterelle. It's got an indented cap that's more like a funnel shape, And when you turn it upright to see the current decurrent gills, here I'll have you hold it like that. Mm-hmm. And this one like that. Perfect. You could see here that these are more like pages of a book. They actually are wide. Well, they're skinny and more like a page. These have got an indent that's more like a ridge. And when you're even closer, you could see that the gills stop at a very marked spot that has a bit of a hump where the stem starts. Here, it's a smooth transition from the lip of the cap all the way down underneath the gill structure to where the stem is. Smooth transition. This is abrupt. This stem here, hold it real hard, is very easily broken, and it's pretty fibrous. Mm-hmm. This stem, when it's broken, hold it pretty firm, much harder to break, more like chicken breast meat. See how it...
Mm-hmm. Stringy.
Yes.
You guys, tell what you know about shaggy manes.
Yeah, they're delicious. You want to eat them before they start to turn into ink.
So, I can see that the earth has been pushed up behind it. It's like they came up and there's this whole layer of a wall of earth behind it. So this is one of the ways they sit apart. You take the mushroom, you rock it all directions, and then you pop it. Follow that? So you're kind of rocking it and breaking the mycelium.
Okay,
so just slowly, you know, adding a little bit and patting it. I'm not going, because mycelium is very sensitive to weight in particular and compaction. It has a cap that is generally smooth, kind of like a hamburger bun. It doesn't have a shine, doesn't have scales, doesn't have a slippery finish. Okay, so those are all things you're looking at here. And this one here, I bet if we cut it in half, it's going to have some places where beetles have eaten in. But if you look at many of these sold in the stores that are dried, you will see holes in them. So people are picking these and selling them through the mushroom companies that dry mushrooms. Now I'll be quiet. And you can just tell what you're doing.
So part of it is I'm cleaning it because I don't wash any of the wild mushrooms I eat. Because they soak it up like water, like a sponge. And so what I do is I trim off, like if I do pick it, like chanterelles I'll cut, but boletes, because you want as much of the stem as you can, because that's some of the best part, I will pluck it. This one, it's tough. Like normally I probably wouldn't pick it because of this little guy on the top bottom, but it's hard sometimes. I'm cutting it off in the field right now because this all here is still active mycelium. This is still alive. And from what I've learned, is that this is one of the easiest ways to transfer body mass of mycelium or mushroom. And you can just put this into the same territory and it will regrow. But also I'm doing this here because I'm trying to hide. I'm not doing it anywhere else because I'm trying to hide that I was here actually doing anything. I don't want people to be able to know. So I'm gonna bury it back in the same area.
That's good. You protect the mushrooms that way too.
In general, it's important to leave mushrooms behind. And so a good rule of thumb is pick only 2/3 of the mushrooms you find, sometimes even half is enough, and leave some mushrooms to reproduce, feed the wild animals. And another important thing is that you walk lightly and visit your patches infrequently.
Skies are coming, but I know that it's hard. I don't think that it's the end, but I know we can keep going.
This is chocolate ocean pudding seaweed.
Yowza. Oh,
this is the one called, what is it called, anybody?
Turkish towel.
Turkish towel, that's right.
Yum, yum.
It's also called chondrocanthus, but we don't need to go into that right now. Okay? So everybody touch that lovely seaweed. That can be used for a scrubby.
Oh, it's
This is called laminaria.
Laminaria.
And it's
and that's
this is sugar rack. That's right. So sugar rack. This is pretty beat up.
It's got the blad in the center.
It's got two rows of seersucker. And when it gets older, it gets more beat up, and it splits all the way down, and you can't quite see the whole structure. But it does have generally two rows of seersucker, and this is. What do I want to say? It's pretty leathery. I wouldn't really harvest this one necessarily, except if I was making dog chews or something. You know? But this one here is the coveted Alaria. Alaria is a feather-shaped seaweed, and we've got the holdfast here, the stipe. These are the reproductive parts here. These are the reason it's called wing kelp, and they're kind of like little wings that come out to the side, and then the main seaweed blade is a long feather with a mid-vein rib that's flat, a strap. And from there goes a kind of ruffled leaf on both sides, but that's wing kelp. So here's the law. The law typically, you still gotta leave the hole fast, even though it's way up here. So I would cut this, get my little scissors here. The law on these long ones here, okay, let me just say, can I have that other one back, that wakame? Again, just to show you guys where you cut it. Okay, so this one here, you're supposed to leave the spore parts, sporophytes, and you would cut this, they say 12 inches from here to here. But you still want to leave these, so cut, right now it's winter and this is basically beat up. But so I would just cut it right there, okay? Yes, this is sea lettuce. So you guys, here is some sea lettuce, Alva. And it's a little bit covered with sediment, but this is a great one to put in a cucumber seaweed salad.
Yeah. And can you dry that too, or is it best to eat fresh?
You know, you can dry this, and it's a lovely seaweed to dry and flake up, and then put on top of eggs or soup. Oh. And this has definitely got a lot of sediment in it, so you just want to wash it really well when you go home.
Okay.
And I would wash it just before you're going to dry it. I would make salt water, basically. Make a salt water bath and wash it in that. Because your fingers are going to get real cold if you're washing it here. So this particular seaweed is a red seaweed, and it's a miniature of Turkish towel. And it's called Turkish washcloth. It has just as much carrageenan in it. And you could, now these ones are pretty darn small, but you could cut off all sorts of little ones like this. Usually they're more like about the size of my palm, right in this area. But Turkish washcloth and Turkish towel have lots of carrageenan in it. So I'm going to pass this around. It looks black, but it actually has little nubbins on it. If you want to feel it with your fingers, you can. You'll feel that it's a little bit like a cat's tongue. It's a little rough, like a cat's tongue. Potato peeler, that's the best thing. Uh-huh. And the potato peeler, you're just going to go down this and take a big long strip off, and it's going to be a gorgeous amber gold underneath. And you just take all those strips and throw them in your compost. And then you'll get this like flute with this beautiful stop sign edge, almost, you know, like eight, nine varieties of facets. And you're gonna cut that, if you're gonna make pickles, into about 1/8 inch wide circles. If you're making chutney, you can chop it sloppy. Mm-hmm. You just, until you get pieces that are maybe about the size of, you know, if you have like a black olive and you're cutting it up to put in salads, little chunks like that. Mm-hmm. And that would be perfect for chutney. A little clothespin right here, and I hang it one layer down, all the way to the floor, just about. And I let that dry, and it's going to dry to parchment. And then I take my scissors once it's dry, and I just cut it in playing card-sized pieces and put it in a jar. Then you can take those playing card-sized pieces and you can crumple them up and put them into eggs. You can pulverize them and powder them and make a powder that you then mix into soups and such. Some people take them for supplements. But you could also take this and fry it in peanut oil and make kelp chips, and they're outstanding tasting. So basically, once this dries again, you cut it into playing card-sized pieces, and you would have some peanut oil heating in a pan, and with some tongs, you just drop it in there real quickly. The other thing you could do is you can make kelp tempura. So you make a tempura batter, and there is a tempura batter in the Pacific Feast for fern fiddleheads, but you could use that tempura batter, and you just put these, a number of these seaweeds are great as tempura. So you guys, these long leaves, I'm gonna encourage you to
find some perfectly nice long leaves like this one. Who wants this one? Huckleberries and blueberries way up there. So that's like, tells you it's great to just give you a mental survey of how much huckleberry and blueberry are produced in the North Cascade Alpine zones and such. Okay, all cars locked? Cool. Woo-hoo. Excited?
Yeah.
Me too. Woohoo! So we've stopped in at the U.S. Forest Service Station, and the reason is it's very important with sustainable harvesting to follow regulations and laws because they're meant to prevent overharvesting. So you get a license if needed. You submit the required harvest records so populations can be monitored for conservation. And in this case, we are looking at some rules that are available both online and here at the Forest Service Station, where you can see the limits on the size and the amount of take and have these in mind as you're looking, whether you're on Forest Service land, Bureau of Land Management, National Forests, national, provincial, state parks, all of them have their own foraging laws. So you want to call ahead or stop in.
That's vascular plants that are sensitive? That one
this,
you said?
This list is vascular plants. This is others. It's got the lichens and the fungus. And you know, when you look into it, there's actually not really any fungus on the list. So I haven't gone through the list personally and just kind of give it to people. It's more the vascular plants. There's some lichens that are on the list.
So we're up here in the North Cascades and picking what's called a black huckleberry. And it's a very shiny huckleberry, and you want to pick on the edges of the bushes, not stepping in to the heather. The heather is easily damaged, and so you can see here too, there's a lot of lichens that can easily be crushed. So a good way of sustainably picking is to stay on the trails and pick over and leave the rest to the animals. There are seasons in the North Cascades where droughts have made it so that the berry population is very small, and they ask pickers not to get huckleberries so that the bears have enough food to go into hibernation and live through the winter on their stores of fat. So do pay attention to the weather systems and the amount of berries from season to season, and you want to change your appetite with the amount of berries that are there. There is a really cool rule called the 1 in 20 rule that's used for harvesting native species. And for instance, berries don't necessarily apply to this, but what you would do is if you were taking blueberry bush leaves for a tea, you would take only 1/20th of the plant's leaves. That's about 5%. And so the 1 in 20 rule applies basically to any kind of area where you're going to take needles from a tree, or if you're going to take one entire plant, there should be 20 of them there. And this again is natives, not invasive or weedy species. It's October 15th, and these nettles are new nettles that have just come up here in October, and these are wonderful for eating. They don't even have that much of a sting for some reason. But typically these are a spring herb, but these are nice and short, and I can take just the upper portion here. I can feel a little bit of a sting. And I've got new nettles, nice, in October. More over here and here. Later in the year, they get sprouts out the side, so these would be good to eat.
This is Doug Fir for Doug Fir tea.
We're gonna make a Doug Fir tea?
We're gonna make a combination tea. You see the new growth? Pick one of them. And you can either cut it or you can pull it.
If it's easier to pull, you can pull.
Wild ginger. I have used the stem, but the
delicious.
Root more. And the root goes trailing along, and we'll have the leaves come up off it.
Is it like a rhizome?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And there are huge areas of it. Isn't that nice? Yeah. It's nice. And it has this beautiful flower, like this one, that is burgundy.